Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? If so, well, you know I want to hear about it. So put all the details of what happened down in an email and send it to contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. I'll get your encounter narrated, and then we can all share in your story. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello there, everyone. Thanks again for stopping by. Now, I don't have a lot of chit-chat up front. I see we got a big old clear set of tracks to follow, so grab that snackage, top up that drink, let's hop in the saddle, and let's follow those prints, because you know where they're going. And he's got a head start on us. He's went straight in to the heart of Sasquatch Valley. Let's get moving, because I don't want him to get the drop on us. I went up 3 days early to do some scouting for a big bull elk in New Mexico near Cloudcroft. Set up my pop-up camper and put a huge tarp over the top. I staked it tight at all the eyelets with rope to the ground, which made a kind of porch area all the way around the camper in case it rained or snowed. First few days were pretty uneventful. It was unusually hot. I was wearing camo shorts and a t-shirt. Back behind our camp, about 400 yards, I noticed a tree bent into an arch. It had the tip touching the ground. I had never seen a sabe, but I knew this type of bent tree was often associated with them. I took a picture of it and didn't think too much about it. One night, I was awoken by something violently shaking the staked rope on one corner of the tarp. There was no wind, not even a breeze. My pit bull sat up, growling very low toward the corner. That was very unusual for him, as he's usually up and running, barking, and growling toward any threat. I pointed my semi-auto bullpup 308 toward the corner, and I turned on the light in the camper, and it stopped. I sat quietly, listening for a while. I didn't hear anything, so I went back to sleep. The next day, my pit bull and I hiked to the top of a mountain that had burned several years ago, all but an L-shaped band of trees. I had called a bull into 35 yards there the previous year, and I harvested him with an old-school flintlock muzzle loader. We snuck down the edge of the L-shaped band of trees, stopping occasionally to cow-call and bugle. When we got to the end of the thin L-shaped band of trees, I walked around the opposite side of trees and sat down, where I could see across the canyon and back behind me through the trees. I did some more calling. My pit bull laid down in tall grass about 15 yards from me. After a couple of series of calling, my pit bull sat up and began to growl real low, looking back behind us toward that band of trees. He doesn't ever make any noise when I'm hunting, so I thought maybe I had called in a mountain lion or bear. Maybe he could smell it. I could see all the way around me, and I couldn't see anything. So I glassed into the trees, but I still never saw anything. That night, a blizzard blew in and dropped 2 feet of snow. I guess I was the only one that didn't know it was coming, as when I got up the next morning freezing, I got a little worried. All the other hunters camped down the road a few miles had already left. I went in to Cloudcroft, and I got a cabin. After the snow stopped and the road crews had cleared the roads, I headed back to get snow off my tarp over the camper before it collapsed my pop-up. On the way into my camper, I spotted 5 bulls laying in a clearing up near the top of the mountain, and I got my bull with my 308. I spent 3 days packing meat off the mountain and didn't have any other strange happenings. I couldn't quit thinking about the rope and the tarp being shook so violently and my pit bull growling and acting scared twice. I know no human would be stupid enough to play games like that in the middle of night during rifle season, and no other animal could shake a rope so violently. I since have researched into sightings and encounters in this area, and I've learned there are way more than I ever would have thought. You can use my name if you like. Signed, Dwayne H. Dear Nance, hello there, fellow female Bigfoot enthusiast. My name is Marquet, and you can go ahead and say it because I have a Bigfoot art website gallery, so I'm not exactly trying to keep this a secret. I'm a 68-year young artist that retired from the banking industry. I've always been an open-minded person, and even before my quote-unquote encounter, I'd always thought it logical that a Bigfoot could exist. After all, it is a vast world with a lot of untouched nature. I enjoyed watching documentaries on Sasquatch because I found them very interesting. However, after my encounter, I really delved into researching the big guys and even began painting pictures of them. So here's what happened. In July of 2020, my husband, Dale, and myself left the sunny south and headed northeast to a conference in Trout Lake, Washington. The purpose was twofold, so that I could meet some fellow YouTubers and also get to see parts of the USA that I'd never seen before. This three-day conference was held in an area that's pretty desolate. Sadly, they had no lodging to offer other than camping in your own tent. I'm chuckling here because I had about zero experience in camping. I didn't own a tent or even a sleeping bag. So before we left on our journey, I went on Amazon and I bought a tent, some cots, sleeping bags, and even a battery-operated fan. Unfortunately, when we got there at 10 p.m., my lack of camping experience really showed. The four-man tent that I'd bought was so small that the cots barely fit inside it. To get them in, they made the tent bulge out ridiculously, and Dale, he had to really struggle to get the door zipper closed all the way. But we managed to get inside and to fall asleep. Sometime in the middle of that first night, Dale woke up because he needed to make an emergency hike to the outhouse. When he finally managed to get the door zipper opened, the top side of my cot and my head popped out like a jack-in-the-box. So I laid there on my tummy, watching and waiting for his return. The outhouses were lit, and they were quite a distance away. But after a while, I spotted someone walking towards me from that area. At first, I thought it was Dale. I mean, who else would be walking around at that hour? But as they approached, I whispered out loud, "Nope, that's not Dale. That dude is way taller than my 6'3" hubby." They drew a little closer, and again I whispered out loud, "And he's way thicker than my 240-pound hubby, too." I felt no fear. I was just laying there, rather amused, as this stranger drew even closer. And I whispered, "Dang, that dude is huge!" Within seconds, that mystery man was on the path directly in front of our tent, about 20 feet away from me. Suddenly, he was no longer silhouetted by the lights of the outhouse area. He was backlit, and I was utterly confused at what I saw. That huge dude changed into a tall, skinny man that was wearing a dark-colored shirt and a baseball hat that was lighter in the back and darker in the front. He walked in front of a narrow tree and simply disappeared. Before I could give that an inkling of a thought, I turned my head, and I saw the silhouette of my husband way in the distance. Now, unlike that other guy, Dale's silhouette looked exactly like his true size. When he made it back to the tent, the struggle with zipping up the door pursued again, and I forgot all about what I had seen. The second night that we were there, Dale fell asleep in about 2 seconds. I was having difficulty falling asleep as thoughts were running through my head about what several people had said during the day. They had warned me about bears being in the area. Good grief. The one thing I was not able to obtain before we got there was some bear spray. Every place we went to was sold out. As I laid there trying to fall asleep, I kept hearing fellow campers snoring, and it was making me so jumpy because it sounded like bears growling. I was so nervous. Then, out of the blue, I heard a whoop. A real whoop, just like the ones I'd heard when listening to the Sierra sounds. And just like that, I thought, good, Bigfoot's here. He can whip a bear, no problem. And with that thought, I let out a sigh and promptly fell asleep. On our third and final day at the conference, we had just finished listening to a speaker and everyone had dispersed. I made my way to the common area fire pit and sat by myself on a long wooden bench. A few minutes later, one of the sound technicians from the conference hall walked up and said, "Hey, want to see my new toy?" I said, "Sure, what you got there?" And I motioned him over to sit beside me. "It's a thermal sensor," he replied. As he sat down, he pushed some buttons and turned it on. "What does it do?" I asked. He enthusiastically explained how the screen displayed different colors for the different heat temperatures that people or other things emit. He began pointing it towards a small crowd of people that were milling about in front of us, about 50 to 75 feet away. Each person, I observed, caused the sensor to respond with red, orange, and yellow blobs coming from their head and torso areas. Nothing showed up on the screen to indicate their feet or hands. I thought the sensor was pretty cool and was really enjoying watching the colors and how accurate the device was. And then somebody walked in front of us. They were walking from the left of us, heading to our right. And that thermal sensor, it lit up. Whoever it was, they caused the screen to capture their heat temperatures perfectly even. Their heat signature registered on that screen as a burned orange color from the top of their head to their fingertips and all the way down to their toes. It looked like the perfect profile of a walking cartoon character of a Bigfoot. "That looks just like a Bigfoot," I gasped. "It sure does," the technician exclaimed. And then he hollered, "Dude, you've got your Bigfoot strut on." But that dude didn't reply. So I looked up from the screen. And what did I see? I couldn't believe it. It was that tall, skinny man. And he was wearing the same thing. But I could see the colors now. He had on a navy blue shirt and a baseball hat that was pale gray in the back and navy blue in the front. It was the same dude that I had seen the first night I was there. It was the one that transformed from a gigantic silhouette into a skinny rail that disappeared in front of a skinny tree. Well, the dude paid no attention to us. He swiftly walked behind a building, and the technician and I both looked at each other and said, "Weird." He turned off his thermal sensor and said, "Well, gotta go, bye." And off he went. I just sat there, putting the pieces together and thinking how improbable all these things were. The timing had to have been absolutely perfect in both cases for me to have seen what I saw. I was dumbfounded. I mean, what are the chances? One in a million. My encounter isn't like anyone else's I've ever heard about. And believe me, I've done a ton of research over the past year, but it changed me. I began painting again and developed a website to display my Bigfoot art. I work with a sketch artist, and we collaborate. She even sketched a picture showing a representation of what I saw with the thermal view. We have it on our website. You can see it on our website. And for you folks listening, rather than spell it all out, I will put it in the the video description below. And she goes on to say that not many squatchers know about my site yet, so feel free to let them know. I just did, Marque. Nance, I really do enjoy listening to your YouTube channel. I'm hooked. You are so good at storytelling, and you have the perfect voice for it. I hope to meet you at a Bigfoot convention one day. Until then, I remain your friend in Bigfoot, Marque. And again, I will put Marque's website information down in the video description below. Buckeye Bigfoot, Nance, or whoever, I do not have a story to tell you. I have a truth to tell you. It's a truth that I saw, and I saw what I saw, and no one will make me say otherwise, and a few have tried. You can use my name. I have no fear of people. But I do have some conflicting things about this truth, and I think there's more truth than I can tell you. You'll understand what I mean, I hope, before I'm done. I was in the Superior National Forest, Isabella Lake area. I had caught some pike minnow and a trout. I took my catch back to camp late afternoon. I cleaned them, and I iced down all but the trout. I had that for dinner. I cleaned up everything good. I know, never leave anything to attract animals. I was in a pop-up camper at the campground. It got late, and I turned my lantern out. I laid there, and I was looking at the sky that was visible over the trees. There were other campers in the area I knew, but I hadn't talked to any of them. My pop-up camper is heavy plastic-like canvas, and it has screens all around when it's popped up. I'd been in the dark for about 30 minutes, maybe more. Then, I suddenly couldn't see anything out there. And then, I saw the sky again. I was confused for just a second. Then I got it. Someone had walked by my camper and blocked my view. But that someone had to be very tall and very wide and very big to block my view at that angle for more than a solid second like that. I was thinking, what the heck is someone doing? Are they going to steal from me? I sat up, I looked, and I listened. Then I had a bad smell that made me gag. It was so bad, I covered my mouth and nose with my shirt, and I tried to breathe that way, but it did not help. That smell was there, but whoever had left the smell had already gone down the way. I laid back down after a minute. I thought, it must be someone just cutting through the area like people sometimes do in campgrounds. Then a woman was screaming, and I heard a man yelling. Sounded like all heck was breaking loose over that way. I got right up right then. I got my gun, and I was looking over that way in the dark. I don't know what I thought I would see. I thought maybe it was a crazy person attacking people. You hear about people getting attacked at campsites and things now. I wanted to help whoever it was, but I wasn't sure where it was and what exactly was happening. What if I got it all wrong and it had nothing to do with the person that just walked through here? Maybe it was just a couple of people over there and they got mad and they were arguing. It could be like that, so I had to be careful. But I thought even just a couple fighting, it sounded like it had gotten out of control. And I also thought that it didn't sound like a couple fighting. It didn't start out small and escalate like most arguments. I got out of my camper and I yelled out if someone needed help. I didn't know if they didn't hear me or couldn't answer. I could still hear chaos over there. I was undecided for a second what I should do, but I kept thinking about that someone who just walked by my camper. Too much coincidence. If it was them, it could be me that was screaming for help right then. And I would sure hope that someone would at least come and check on me. So I made up my mind, and I made my way over there. I was thinking, if there's a fight going on between two guys, maybe I could help even the odds out. I knew that the really tall guy that blocked my view was probably not going to be the guy that belonged in that camp. I would have noticed someone that tall earlier in the day. I didn't know what I was doing or what the plan was for me. I don't think I had a plan. It just sounded like someone needed help. That's all I could think about. I didn't want to turn my lantern back on, but I did have a small flashlight that threw good light. I grabbed it and started making my way over. I had my flashlight on, so they could see that someone was coming. But then I saw another light. It was flicked on. It was those campers, and it was shining on something big and hairy. I stopped, thinking I was looking at a bear standing up. I was maybe 50 or 60 feet away. It's hard to judge in the dark. All the yelling stopped for about 2 seconds. Then I heard the woman start yelling, "Oh my God! Oh my God!" And then they both started yelling again, and the light was shining everywhere. The bear didn't seem bothered by any of this noise, but it didn't like the light. I was relieved to see that it was retreating. And I thought, it's such an odd-looking bear, and it's acting odd, too. Part of me recognized that, but I didn't dwell on it. I changed my direction, and I came around in an arc so that while I was still getting close to the campers who might need help, I was keeping far to the side and behind the bear that seemed to be retreating. I was tracking it with my light as it walked away. I wanted to make sure it was continuing to retreat. I didn't want to run into it if it came back. I guess if I had to, I would try to shoot, but I knew my handgun would be no help against a bear. Then I got it. I got it just like that. I got that what it was wasn't a bear. I saw it. It was a real Bigfoot. It had turned my way for just a second. But my light, it shone right in its eyes. It didn't like that. It turned away. But I saw it, Nance. I saw it. I saw that Bigfoot's face. That was not a bear nose. There were no ears. And now it made all sense why I thought it was an odd-looking bear. Because it wasn't a bear. Oh, it was ugly, all right. But it was very human-looking. Mostly, I saw its backside while it was walking away. But when it turned in that second, I knew right then. I knew the truth. I was a knower. I saw truth. And I will never be made to say different. I couldn't think to do something. You always think you know what you would do in any situation. And maybe you will. And maybe you won't do that thing. I don't know what I thought I might have done if I'd ever seen a Bigfoot if you had asked me before that night. But no matter what I said, I know what I actually did do. Nothing. I didn't make a sound. I didn't say anything. When I couldn't see it anymore, I went back to my camper and I stayed there. My big idea to help people was all gone. I watched the other people. They tossed their things in quick and they got out of there. They didn't pack. I'm telling you, they were tossing things crazy inside their camper and truck. They pulled out of there in a hurry. They did not come to speak to me. I did not speak to them. It seems weird now, I know, but it seemed right at the time. Maybe they didn't even know I was there with all the chaos. It still seems unlikely. But maybe they really didn't know that I was making my way over to help. I know you're wondering if I was peeing myself, as all kinds of people say. No, I was not scared. I was not terrified. I do, however, think I was in a state of shock. I really don't know what I thought on as I sat there in my camper afterwards. The thought to go sit in my truck instead of the pop-up camper did cross my mind, and I immediately said no, and I asked myself, why would I do that? I didn't feel scared. I remember thinking that. And after that, I don't remember thinking anything. I don't know what I thought about until it got light outside. Everything is a big blank for hours. I sat there all night till sunup. At least, I think I did. I can't tell you much about it. But when it got to be sunup, I packed up and left. It wasn't a hurried thing, and it wasn't fear that made me leave. I don't know why I left. I felt like now everything was out of step. Everything was not going to be okay unless I left. But it wasn't fear. That sounds jumbled up, and it is, but it's the only way I know to tell you. So, okay, I said to myself, Bigfoot's real. Is that why you're leaving? And part of me said, yes, that was why you need to leave. So I said to myself, you're scared. And I thought about it. And then my mind said, no, you're not. And I don't think I was. It was a strange flat spot every time I talked about being scared to myself. It just went flat. I think something happened during my time while sitting in the pop-up camper until the sun came up. I try to think about all those hours, and there were a lot of them, I know. But when I think about it, it's just a flat blank spot in my head, like a piece of tape that's been erased, you know, like an old cassette tape. Just a hissing noise through that part. I almost have a memory that I keep smelling that gagging smell all night long. It sounds incredible, but I really think it came back. I think I saw it in the dark outside my camper again. But either I have blocked it from my memory, or it blocked it from my memory. All I know is that part of my mind, well, that cassette tape is just hissing. There's nothing there. Now that might sound absurd, but I have no other explanation. When I think about that night, I have feelings that make no sense. It's all calm and it's all blank and back and forth. What I can remember is what I have told you. But I cannot shake this feeling that there's more. I just can't remember it. I remember almost nothing of all the hours sitting in the dark in my camper. Yet somehow, I'm very clear, and I remember the sun coming up, and I have clear memories of even what I was thinking while I packed things up. I remember the drive home. I remember singing along to certain songs on the radio. But those hours overnight in the dark? Nothing. It's blank. I just remember the smell at the edge of one of my memories. Do you think it might have come back? Can Bigfoot take your memory away? Have you ever heard of that? Can he make you so scared that your mind blocks things out and you don't even know it? I don't know. I still go fishing, hunting, and camping. It hasn't changed any of that for me. I have no new fears. So I guess that's part of my confusion. I have missing time and memory, but I'm not frightened. I don't feel fear. I saw it clearly, but I'm not scared if I should happen to see it again. But I think I should be. That's what perplexes me. It goes against everything that I've heard or read. Signed, Maurice Withams. All right, Sasquatch. Now, our last story comes to us from Christopher, who, as you may remember, has been very busy over the last several months collecting stories from a lot of the people all around LaFleur, Arkansas. Now, if you want to hear some of the other testimonies that Christopher has been successfully getting from a lot of the people in that area, especially a lot of the older people, I'll be sure to leave a link in the video description for that as well. So here is the latest sent in from Christopher. Hello, Nance. I have heard that old saying, beware of what you wish for. With the high price of lumber, I had to change tactics in my line of work to make a dollar. Mr. Hancock called me and asked if I was too proud to build a fence. I told him it was my favorite thing to do, right up there with hauling hay. I jumped at the chance to build his fence and to see the creek where he met the little Indian with my own two eyes. I wouldn't be building the fence alone. Two of his grandsons and a nephew would be building the fence. It didn't take long for the fun to run out of the project, so I lost my help after 2 days. Which is fine with me. I work better alone. The first day working alone, I had 3 gallons of water disappear. I didn't drink it, and it wasn't poured out. When I went back to Mr. Hancock's to get more water, Mr. Hancock urged me to quit for the day and cool off. Mr. Hancock showed me the creek where he had met the little Indian and the old barn where the little Indian buried his dad. He drove me around his place on his mule. He told me to keep a gallon of water on my person so I wouldn't go thirsty, and when I drank my water, quit for the day. He then looked me in the eye with a serious spark in his eye. "Do you still have a pistol?" he asked. "Yes, sir, but why ask me that?" I asked. "Did you bring it?" he asked. "No, I quit carrying it when Linda died," I answered. "Well, I have one you can borrow," he answered. "I don't need a pistol to build a fence," I said. "It's not for the fence, but I would feel better if you would carry it," Mr. Hancock said. "Okay," I said. "But would I really need a pistol?" I asked. "There's a red-colored critter that has been seen through here, and when I seen it, I had a bolt of fear go through me," Mr. Hancock said. "It's not like the little Indian. No, this one is evil. And you're here alone, and I don't want anything to happen to you." Now, I knew he was not joking about the new critter. "I know you're not a hunter," he continued. "But if you get a chance to shoot it, aim for the head." "Okay," I said. Mr. Hancock pulled up behind his house. "Come in," he said. "The missus made supper." Now, even though it was only 5:30, I went in and washed up and sat at the table. Mrs. Hancock made a fine supper of fried squash and okra and boiled cabbage. Mr. Hancock laid a .357 on the table with semi-full box of shells. We ate supper, listening to the Andy Griffith Show on the TV. Mr. Hancock said, "I could give you one bullet to put in your pocket like Andy did Barney." Mrs. Hancock chuckled. "Well, that you could," I said. The thought of me carrying a pistol made me nervous. I have not carried a pistol in 8 years. I have not even fired a gun in 5 years. During my time building the fence, I stayed in a cabin that Mr. Hancock used to let kinfolk stay in when they were visiting. I went to bed, and about 3 a.m, I woke up to answer nature's call. I went on the porch, and I sat down to hear a large ape-like roar that echoed in that little valley. It was coming from the area that I was building the fence. I could feel that I was being watched. Not the feeling of a watchful, caring eye, but the feeling of the booger man that was going to get me. I went back inside the cabin and locked the door. I checked the pistol. It was clean. I only put 4 bullets in it. I laid on the couch, and when the alarm clock rang, I got up and headed to the fence. I only had 5 hours more, and the fence would be done. I parked the mule halfway down the fence row so I could keep an eye on my extra water. I worked quick so I would get done early so I could get back to my house. I finally put the last stay in the fence. I headed toward Mr. Hancock's house. I saw that critter's outline in the trees, and I felt fear go through me. I could sense that this critter was evil. When I pulled into Mr. Hancock's yard, he was sitting on the back porch. "You seen him?" Mr. Hancock said. "Yeah, just an outline, but I got that feeling of fear. And that big stinker gives off an evil vibe," I said. "Yes, he does," Mr. Hancock said. "Since he showed up, I haven't seen the new little Indian or her mother. There's two big males that make their rounds early in the morning and around sunup. When the red one smells them, he runs them off, and then he hides. But I haven't seen them during the day. I think that they are looking for the red one." "Well, maybe they'll dish out their own justice then," I said. Mr. Hancock paid me my wages, and I went home. A week later, I came back to Mr. Hancock's, and he said the next morning after I left, he went to inspect my work. And there in the fresh soil of the new fence row was a beat-up spread in the dirt. He said it looked like a massive bear fight had taken place there. He said that whatever had taken place there was bad. And that evening, he said, he saw the big red one limping into the timber line. He was using a pair of binoculars, and he said that he could see the big red one had chunks missing, and he looked like he was going to die. That red sucker was heading away from the house and to the mountains. Mr. Hancock said that buzzards circled the mountain, but when he went out and checked for a body, he didn't find one. But there was a large pile of dirt and some rocks that he hadn't seen there on a ridge. As for my missing water, I would like to think that the new little Indian felt safe enough to drink my water. But I never, ever saw her. But I did see a huge outline of a very large critter. All right, everyone. Well, if you don't know what Christopher was referring to when he mentioned the new little Indian or the barn, those are some previous stories that he collected, especially from Mr. Hancock. So if you are curious, I'll put the links to Christopher's other stories in the description below. All right, everyone, I do hope you've enjoyed them. I don't have a lot of other chit-chat for you. Again, if you've got anything you want to submit for some Halloween goodies, send it in. I'll accept fiction, but make sure you mark it as fiction. I would love to get some Halloween-type Bigfoot encounters, something extra scary. All right, so send those in. Be sure to put Halloween in the subject heading. Otherwise, that's it. I'm going to wrap it up tonight. It's been a long one, and I've enjoyed it. But don't be sad. You know we'll be meeting up again real soon. And until we do, you know what you need to do, don't you? Always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone. Well, boy, howdy, how'd you like that? You just got sassed by that Squatch. Now, if you liked it, and you're ready to get some more sassy squatching thrown at you, be sure to hit that like and subscribe button, because he will absolutely love you for it. Thank you.